those of you who may have come from the old church, I want to let you know now, I'm not going to say anything negative here about our people or our community. So I'm putting you on notice that this is truly an affirming church, an affirming house, and we love all of God's people. If you will turn with me to Mark chapter 5, verse 25, Mark chapter 5, and if you'll stand for the reading of God's word. Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 25. When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of the plague. Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? His disciples said unto him, thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. He said unto her, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. I want to tag this particular text this afternoon. I feel all right. I feel all right. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. After attending many sports events, I realized one day that many churches are in need of what every football team has, and they are called cheerleaders. The job of a cheerleader is to tell everybody we're going to make it. No matter how bad things look on the scoreboard, cheerleaders let you know there is still hope. No matter who seems to be winning, cheerleaders encourage you to not give up and not give in. No matter how much time is left in the game, cheerleaders still say, we can make it. Cheerleaders cheer all the way to the end of the game and will act like the team is winning by a large score, even when there is no possible way that a victory will come. Their job is simply to cheer and lead the people in cheering for their team. When folks come in today's sanctuary with both broken lives and broken hearts, with broken dreams, broken realizations, and broken connections with their God, they need to run into some cheerleaders who can encourage them on their journey. In other words, they need to run into some Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized, Bible believing, authentic living saints who are willing to cheer them on and tell them that they can make it. Is anybody willing to be a cheerleader in God's house on today? Not one who says the line just to be saying them. Not one who can't be found when there's a crisis going on. Y'all know how we disappear. Not one who's afraid to shout out during the seemingly rough times. But one who doesn't have a problem telling the world about Jesus and how Jesus will make everything all right. We need some spirit-filled cheerleaders, church, who ain't scared to encourage somebody else along the way. Some who can get excited about speaking positive things into somebody else's life. Some who can get excited when there's a challenge on the rise, because they know that's an opportunity for God to prove God's self. Church, we need some willing and able cheerleaders on today who can call somebody else to get excited about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Call some other folks to get excited about how things are about to turn around in your life. Call some other folks to shout about the fact that no matter what's going on, still that expect a miracle. Still believe for greater. Still trust God and the fact that God is bigger than your circumstance. Everybody, the way I see it, ought to be a cheerleader in God's house on today. Here we are in our text where this woman has an issue of blood, and she's had it for 12 long years. Now, every time I read this text, the first thing I want to know is what issue did she have? What was her issue of blood? We know medicine was not as advanced during biblical days as it is now, so we might not ever really know what her issue was. However, when we think of blood diseases today and what causes issues on in our body, when there is a problem with our blood, we have to ask the question, was she possibly suffering with sickle cell anemia? Was she possibly suffering with leukemia? Was she possibly suffering with peripheral vascular disease? Or maybe she was suffering with HIV? We will never know what she was suffering with, and we will never know what was going on in her system, but we can conclude that there could have been numerous things going on in her body that the local doctors could not diagnose, that the specialists could not cure, that money could not change. That's why the scripture informs us that even though she had spent all that she had, she grew even worse. Church, as I studied this text, I thought it was quite strange that it was not until after she had spent all of her money, somebody noticed that, that she then seeks out Jesus. Before she gave away her life savings, if you think about it, she should have had a talk with Jesus, or maybe even talk to some of the Holy Ghost field cheerleaders. These cheerleaders had been through some stuff, and they could have testified about God's saving grace. The cheerleaders that's been through some stuff, she should have talked to them because they had been down on their sick bed surely, and they could have testified about God's healing power. The cheerleaders, if she had talked to them, surely some of them had been down to their last dime. They could have testified about praising God anyhow in the midst of rough times. She should have talked to some cheerleaders that could have testified that they almost gave up, but God stepped in just in the nick of time. I believe she should have crossed paths with some cheerleaders at some point who could say they've been tied up, they've been shackled up, they've been tangled up and jacked up, and aren't afraid to testify about God's deliverance power. And I came to tell somebody today, I believe we got some cheerleaders in this house who have weathered the storm. You've been through the storm and the rain, and I can tell you how you know them. You'll know them because they'll be the ones waving their hands before heaven. You'll know them because they'll be the ones saying, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. They'll be the ones dancing on their feet. They'll be the ones clapping their hands and shouting hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Church, we got to realize that God's got a solution to our problem. But we've got to be willing to try the Lord and trust the Lord on today. So the question becomes, what is it that you've been plagued with for many years? And you need to find your way to Jesus. Might God be saying that the time is out for going everywhere else and looking in all the wrong places? For surely this is the place. This is the time. These are the people. Have any of you ever arrived at a football game and wondered which side your team was on? You know how we get there and we're looking to see which side is our team. And you had to look for the cheerleaders or the mascot in order to determine which side you should be sitting on, so that you would be seated with others who are cheering for your team as well. It is oftentimes comforting to know that you're in the right place with the right people. I want to propose to you all today that the woman with the issue of blood finally ended up at the right place with the right person that day when she showed up where Jesus was. When you end up in the right place, I believe you'll get clarity on your situation. Does anybody need some clarity on today? You see, when she saw Jesus and the crowd that was standing around, and when she felt the energy level that was highest among the people that were there that day, and when she observed how excited the people were about this man who could heal anybody from anything at any time, this woman at the point where it became very clear that she was at the right place at the right time with the right people. Sometimes, church, it's not until you arrive at that place, your place of destiny, that you take a chance on. You're taking a chance on going there because you've heard about it. It's not until you step out on faith and go where the Spirit is leading you. It's not until then that you are able to confirm some things in your life. See, you've got to get away from the naysayers that are in your ear. And you've got to realize that in this right place, that the blessing is in the atmosphere. And I'm just crazy enough to believe that in all the other places this woman had been, something inside of her felt that this is not the place. This is not quite right. But she went ahead and took a chance on those places, those unfamiliar places, those places that did not bless her. Do we have any risk takers in the house on today? You're willing to do what you feel is going to get you what you want. You're willing to go wherever your passion will take you. You're willing to give it all on a chance that may or may not yield you the return that you're seeking. You're willing to do whatever it takes, even though the probability of you getting what you desire is very low. You're simply a risk taker and not afraid to lose it all. Well, church, even risk takers can feel when the risk is too great. But they can also feel when the risk is worth it all. You see, in spite of what everybody else says, when you know it's right, there's something that boils over in you. There is something that takes over you that you can't explain. There is something that assures you. You hit the jackpot this time. This is different from every other time. And I just believe this woman that Mark describes as a certain woman. I believe she knew this was it this time. I believe her inner spirit told her this wasn't going to turn out like all the other times. She knew this was what she had been searching for. She knew this was going to make all the difference in the world. She could feel it. The closer she moved towards the crowd where Jesus was, the more she could feel her life about to change. Isn't it sad, church, that sometime before we will look to Jesus or try to go where we may find him, things have to be worse or horrible in our lives. Before we will seek Jesus out, things have to almost become a tragedy in our lives. Before we will make up in our mind that we need the Lord and that we can't make it without him, things have to almost be deadly in our situation. Church, we gotta seek Jesus when times are good and when times are bad. We gotta seek Jesus when we're up and when we're down. We gotta seek Jesus when we're blessed and when we're waiting on the blessing. You gotta seek Jesus each and every day of your journey. Don't wait until you're in trouble to find the Lord. Church, now the woman with the issue of blood had finally realized that she was in the right place at the right time in her life. She had clarity that Jesus was the blessing that she needed. But now there were people who were circumventing her blessing. Does anybody know about blessing blockers on today? These are people who stand in the way intentionally of your blessing. The crowd was there that day following Jesus, trying to get their own blessing. The Bible says that many people followed him and thronged him, which means there were other folk in line, in essence, in front of her, trying to get what they needed from Jesus as well. Y'all know how people feel like what they need is more important than what's going on in your life and what you need at this moment. And as I thought about this thing, I realized somebody had to have seen this woman crawling on the ground, but they decided step on your, I'm going to preach to the lights today. They step on your dreams. They step on your accomplishments. They step on your heart in order to put themselves in front of you. How do you know that people will act just like you're not there when it comes to them getting their blessing over yours? They will act like you don't exist when it comes to them getting their promotion over yours. They'll act like you're unqualified, undignified, unprepared when it comes to them being recognized over you. It's unfortunate, but when you're being circumvented, church, you'll become invisible as they make themselves visible. You'll become hated as they make themselves loved. You'll become questionable as they make themselves trustworthy. You'll become weighted down as they make themselves liberated. So what are you doing? What are you going to do when you have people who are stopping you, blocking you, hindering you, circumventing you from getting to your blessing? Something inside of your church must raise up with determination, just like it did to this certain woman, and say, ain't nobody going to stop me from getting my blessing. Somebody missed it. Somebody missed it. If I got to crawl through the crowd to get to Jesus, that's what I'm willing to do. If I have to let the people step on me as I make my way to Jesus, that's what I'm willing to do. If I have to put my head close to the ground and be quiet as I slither my way to Jesus, that's what I'm willing to do. If I have to get bumps and bruises as I press my way to Jesus, that's what I'm willing to do. Whatever it takes, I'm determined to get to the Lord. Church, I promise you, if you would just tell yourself whatever it takes to get to the Lord, I'm willing to do, you are guaranteed to be able to touch the hem of his garment. The Bible says that she came in the press behind and touched his garment. As I thought about this, I said, there is something significant when you can get your blessing from behind. Y'all stay with me. You see, in the front, everybody can see you and will try to block you. But when you go around, which I believe she did, and get it from behind, it's just you and the Lord. Somebody needs to get that. It's just you and God. Because folks usually are not worried about who's behind Jesus, because they're so focused about who's in front of him. They're not worried about any healing taking place behind Jesus. They're just worried about who's getting their healing in front of him. They're not worried about if deliverance is occurring behind Jesus. They just want to make sure that the deliverance is occurring in front of him. His power is still the same on the top as it is on the bottom. His power is still the same on the inside as it is on the outside. So don't worry about where it comes from. Just focus on getting to the one who has all power in his hands. And in spite of those who try to circumvent you, know that God will be available to release the blessing to you. So if you make up in your mind that you're going to get to Jesus in spite of those who may try to block you, once you get to him, you've got to be able to connect with him. Church, I'm suggesting here that the woman with the issue of blood had to connect with Jesus. It's one thing to make it where Jesus is, but it's another thing to connect with him, to align yourself with him, to entrust yourself to him, to experience his power and benefit from all that he has to offer. There are some connections that need to be made today that have been left unconnected for years. There is a Holy Ghost connection that somebody needs to make today before it's too late. There is a divine that you need to get today before you lose your mind and lose all that God has given you. Somebody needs to connect with the Savior on today. Somebody needs to reach out and touch his garment on today and be made whole. Somebody needs the healing power of the Savior on today so that your life can be transformed and you'll never be the same again. But you can't get that transformation staying at home. You can't get that transformation looking around at other people, waiting on them to make a decision. You can't get that transformation waiting on your mama, waiting on your daddy, waiting on your friends to change their opinion about you. You can't get that transformation holding on to what an old church taught you. Holding on to what an old preacher said to you. Holding on to what an old saint and old prophet spoke over you. You can't get that transformation. Wait on your partner. Wait on your lover. Wait on your spouse to go with you. You gotta get up, church, and go for yourself. You gotta make up your own mind and present your own self to the Lord. You gotta surrender to him and realize that he's all that you need. You gotta be ready now for some things to change and to change for your good. Is anybody ready to change on today? If you need the Savior, you gotta reach out and touch the Lord. There was a song that used to say, reach out and touch. And said, you gotta be willing, like the lady with the issue of blood, to reach out and touch his garment. Because Jesus freely gives on today. Now that you have clarity about Christ and understand that your blessing is in the atmosphere, and you've made up in your mind that you are moving beyond all of those who are trying to circumvent your blessing and circumvent your release from heaven, you've decided to now connect with Jesus, then I want to tell you that your issue is canceled in Christ's name. It's canceled because the power surge that goes through you after you connect with Christ can cancel any issue that is plaguing your body or causing you some challenges. The Bible says that the certain woman with the issue of blood, time she touched Jesus' garment, the fountain of her blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Wow. All I can tell you today, church, is that you'll know when you made a true connection with the Lord. You'll feel it all over your body. You'll feel it down in your soul. It'll feel like fire all over you. It'll be something you cannot explain. It'll put running in your feet and clapping in your hands. And anything that was wrong will now become right. Anything that was old will now become new. Anything that was dried up, church, will begin to flow again. Anything that was dead will now have life. That's because the power of Jesus has just restored you and made you whole again. That Jesus tells her.